This is the much-needed upgrade to the overvoltage protection circuit I made a while back. The previous circuit was designed to be set up once and go into its forever home, namely my pick-and-place machine. The general idea is for the input voltage to be shunted across a power resistor when the overvoltage threshold is exceeded. This protects the devices on the power rail from voltage spikes like when switching inductive loads or during regenerative braking, which can and have killed motion control boards. I've been using this circuit for quite a while now, so let's do a quick review of its performance. For starters, to set the threshold voltage, I have to apply that voltage to the board with a bench power supply and adjust the potentiometer with a screwdriver until the overvoltage protection kicks in. I never know which direction to adjust the 25-turn potentiometer, and there's no feedback whatsoever, so I always end up just turning it whichever random way feels right. If that doesn't work, then I'll try the other way. I put an LED on the board to indicate when the overvoltage protection is triggered, but really, nobody's gonna notice it unless they're staring right at the LED when it happens. The power connection to the board was frankly a little too janky for my liking, and the overall aesthetics of the device also leaves quite a lot to be desired. But well, at least it works. If you want a detailed description of this circuit, feel free to check out the video I made about it. Because of the painful user experience with this device, I often end up simply not using it. During dynamometer testing, I ended up destroying more stuff, this time two TMC2209 stepper motor drivers, which could probably have been saved. So I decided something needed to be done, stat. I need a new overvoltage protection device that I'd actually use. For that to happen, the overvoltage threshold should be easily configurable. It's also pretty useful to have a display showing what the current threshold even is. And keeping account of the number of overvoltage events would also be handy. It'll definitely need better power connectors. And I wouldn't be opposed to having it look a little less janky. So let's see what kind of components we'll need. In the previous circuit, we didn't even use a microcontroller. But now, we want some kind of a display for the overvoltage threshold and the event counter. It could be an OLED module, an LCD character display, or a simple 7-segment LED display. Either way, we're gonna need a microcontroller. Since we're going down the microcontroller route, we have more ways to implement overvoltage detection. For example, we could use the microcontroller's ADC to continuously sample the input voltage and use a GPIO pin to control the shunt's MOSFET. If we did it this way, we'll be able to configure the overvoltage threshold in firmware, but the response time will be limited by the ADC's sampling time and the processing time, among other things. If we weren't careful, we could end up with a response time in the milliseconds. For an overvoltage protection device, we want the response time to be as fast as possible. So instead, I've chosen to use an external comparator, which should give us sub-microsecond response times. The comparator has one job. If the voltage at the non-inverting input is higher than the voltage at the inverting input, its output is asserted, and vice versa. For our application, we apply our input voltage to the non-inverting input, and we supply a reference voltage to the inverting input. The reference voltage is what determines the overvoltage protection threshold. The comparator's output goes to the MOSFET, so that if the input voltage exceeds the reference voltage, the MOSFET will be switched on, shunting the input voltage through a power resistor, like one of these. There's of course a little more to it than this block diagram suggests, but we'll get to the details when reviewing the schematics. Knowing that the core functionality will be implemented using a comparator, let's now figure out how we can supply the reference voltage to set the overvoltage threshold. I've had it with using a screwdriver to turn a tiny knob, so I'm going to have to pass on using a potentiometer like in the previous circuit. I want a better user interface, something akin to this bench power supply. Essentially, it's a combination of a rotary encoder and a button, which is really not too much trouble since we have a microcontroller. We'll convince the microcontroller to track the inputs from the rotary encoder and button and show us what we're doing through a simple user interface. Finally, we need to convert the voltage threshold we've set in firmware to an actual analog reference voltage we can feed into the comparator. For this, we'll simply use a digital to analog converter, or DAC. We've now figured out the types of components we'll need for the circuit. For the comparator, we want something with a fast response time, and ideally, an output we can use to drive a MOSFET's gate directly. As it so happens, there's a comparator designed for protection circuits that meets these requirements, the TLV1805. It has a quick response time of under 1 microsecond, and its output is push-pull and capable of high peak currents of over 100 milliamps. Done. The ATtiny1616 was an easy choice for the microcontroller. I enjoyed using it in my flashlight project, and it has a built-in DAC. The DAC only has 8-bit resolution, but we have a solution for that that we'll talk about later in the video. That's another two down. For the encoder, I've selected this guy from Alps Alpine. It's a pretty standard rotary encoder with detents. Conveniently, it has a built-in push switch. So that means we can check off another two items off our list. This leaves us with the final item on the list, the display. On the one hand, 7-segment displays are simple, large, and look right at home next to a bench power supply. On the other hand, these tiny OLED displays consume less power and are much more versatile in what can be displayed. You have already seen the thumbnail and introduction, so it's no surprise that I decided to keep it simple and went with the 7-segment display over the OLED. Technically, these are 8-segment displays because of the decimal points, and that actually contributes a little more complexity that we'll talk about later. Let's have a look at the schematics. The encoder has a standard quadrature output and a switch. The datasheet recommends RC filtering on the quadrature output, so that's what these components are. Our microcontroller, the ATtiny1616, only needs one decoupling capacitor and a connector for programming. As microcontrollers go, this is as simple as it gets. Here, I have my two common cathode 8-segment displays for a total of 6 characters. To drive them, I chose the TM1652, which can be configured for either 6 7-segment characters or 5 8-segment characters. The astute among you would have realized neither of these options work for our 6-character 8-segment display. Luckily, I'm really only interested in driving one of the decimal points. So I've configured the driver for 6 7-segment characters and added this hack to control the one decimal point I'm interested in. Honestly, it would have been simpler to just use a driver that can handle 6-character 8-segment displays like the MAX7219, but implementing the hack was kind of fun. See if you can figure out why I did it this way, and let me know your answers in the comments. The power circuit's a little more involved. Because I wanted the device to support a relatively wide range of input voltages, up to 60 volts, I didn't want to just slap an LDO on and call it a day. A 55-volt dropout voltage would be a bit much. Instead, we first use a DC to DC step-down converter to get about 9 volts. The output of the DC to DC converter would have high frequency noise, which may or may not affect the operation of the analog circuitry. So, to be safe, we put the 9-volt line through an RC low-pass filter. The output of the RC filter has a high impedance, so here, the output is buffered with an emitter follower. Finally, we use an LDO to give us a clean 5-volt source. We can now look at how everything comes together. Taking center stage, we have our protagonist, the TLV1805 comparator. The TLV1805 cannot handle the maximum 60-volt input voltage that the device should support, so we use a potential divider at a non-inverting input. This extra resistor configures the hysteresis to 1 volt, and all 3 resistor values need to be calculated together to achieve the desired behavior. As usual, I wrote a script for these calculations. Like we planned, the VREF is supplied by the DAC from the microcontroller, but through an RC low-pass filter. Remember how the DAC only has 8 bits of resolution? In a bad case, this means the DAC's output resolution is about 17 millivolts, which corresponds with an overvoltage threshold resolution of about 0.24 volts. Practically, this is perfectly fine, but it would be nicer if it could get it down to a number like 0.1 volts. And this low-pass filter is part of the solution. See, we really only need VREF to be constant during operation. The ATtiny1616's DAC, however, has the capability to output 350,000 samples per second. So we're going to trade some of this sample rate for some extra resolution by using oversampling. To explain how oversampling works, let's consider a hypothetical 2-bit DAC that operates on 3 volts. It's able to output 0 volts, 1 volt, 2 volts, and 3 volts. So if we wanted 1.5 volts, we are out of luck. But if we don't need the full sampling rate, we could do this. By alternating between 1 volt and 2 volts, the average is theoretically the 1.5 volts that we want. To actually implement averaging in the circuit, we would use a low-pass filter, resulting in an output that looks something like this. Doing it this way, there'll be ripple. In our application, we minimize the output ripple by using a low cutoff frequency in a low-pass filter and by using a high DAC sampling rate. If you've enjoyed the video so far, please subscribe to the channel. Okay, let's keep going. The output of the TLV1805 comparator is intended to drive a MOSFET's gate directly, so that's what we'll do. On board, I have two low inductance power resistors in parallel, each rated for up to 35 watts. 70 watts is nothing compared to a proper braking resistor, so we need to be careful not to overload the device. To check if the resistors are heating up too much, I've also included an NTC thermistor. For higher power applications, we would need to use external power resistors, but that's a problem for another time. One of the design goals was to improve the look of the device, which is not exactly a tall order. So I went to CAD and drew up a box. I couldn't figure out a way to have the screw terminal block be on the same PCB without sacrificing the form factor, so I ended up having to use a separate PCB for just the screw terminal block. Then I went back and forth between Fusion and KiCad until I had the complete PCB designs. With that done, I sent the files to PCBWay to have the PCBs made and assembled. I used PCBWay's KiCad plugin for this, which automated most of the process. This would come back to haunt me later. They sent me a couple of pictures for me to check that everything looked as expected, and a few days later, I received a bunch of beautifully assembled and cleaned boards. This saved me a substantial amount of manual labor, so I'm extremely thankful to PCBWay for providing this service to my channel free of charge. With the PCBs in hand, I 3D printed the enclosure, and it just happened to have the color scheme of a partially ripe lemon, but I quite like it. Writing the firmware was a breeze, relatively. I had a bit of trouble with the TM1652's bit-banged serial interface, but it turned out to be just a silly mistake with forgetting to reverse the bit order on some of the commands. Since this is a relatively simple device, it only took me a few nights to get most of the functions implemented. Let's take a tour of the device. It's powered through this screw terminal block and can handle voltages between 12 volts and 60 volts. The input power is passed through, so downstream devices can be connected here. The top display shows the overvoltage threshold, which we can adjust by depressing and using a knob. The bottom display shows the number of overvoltage events since startup, which is useful for finding out if any unexpected voltage spikes are happening. Let's hook up an oscilloscope to find out how well this thing is working. I've set the overvoltage threshold to 15 volts, so let's ramp up the voltage on the bench power supply until it triggers the overvoltage protection. The event counter has increased, and the oscilloscope has triggered. The focus is a little off, but we can still just about see that it triggered around 16 volts. A full volt off the target is pretty bad, especially after all the work we've done with the DAC to improve the resolution. I did specify pretty high value resistors in the potential divider, which wouldn't help with the accuracy. But there is something else that draws suspicion. Let's run a quick experiment. Let's apply a fixed voltage to the device and measure the output of the potential divider. It's holding fairly steady at 0.79 volts. And now I'm going to hit it with the hot air gun. And there's a massive change in output from just a whiff of the hot air gun. The circuit is extremely sensitive to temperature, and honestly, impressively responsive too. This means the resistors have extremely high temperature coefficients, much higher than even carbon film resistors. They're more like thermistors. Let's take a closer look. Here's the NTC thermistor that I specified for measuring the temperature near the power resistors. And here are the resistors that form the potential divider and the hysteresis circuit. This footprint in particular is meant to be populated with a 10K resistor, but it looks a little different from the other resistors, doesn't it? In fact, it looks a little familiar. Sure enough, using the PCBWay plugin for KiCad, the generated bill of materials grouped all components with the value 10K together. In this case, 11 10K resistors and 1 10K thermistor. Of course, it's my fault that I didn't notice the mistake. If I were lucky, the 10K thermistor would have ended up as a 10K resistor, which would mean I only have to replace one 0402 component. But of course, that didn't happen, so I have to change 11. Time for some rework. As it happens, I recently bought this new toy, tool. It's a cheap pair of hot tweezers, so I thought I'd give it a shot. I've seen it used on bigger components like 0805 resistors, but I haven't found a video on YouTube demonstrating it with 0402 parts. The thermistor is much taller than a typical 0402 resistor, and I can just about grip the part. The solder is starting to melt a little, but I don't think it's making sufficient thermal contact to really work. Adding some extra solder would probably do the trick, but these tweezers aren't going to be any help with placing the new 0402 resistors back on, so I'll have to break out my hot air gun anyway. I've actually ordered a more expensive pair of hot tweezers after this experience, so I'll do a comparison between them another time. Okay, we're back in business. Let's see what proper metal film resistors can do for us. The device triggers around 15.3 volts, so it's much better than before. It still isn't exact, but it is close enough for overvoltage protection. However, we can make the threshold a tiny bit more accurate by implementing a calibration sequence. The calibration sequence involves applying two known voltages and telling the device what these voltages are using the dial. We measure the output of the potential divider with the microcontroller's ADC. And with two measured values and two known input voltages, we can replace the theoretical potential divider calculations with a linear map that's hopefully more accurate. After calibration, the overvoltage protection kicks in at around 15.1 volts, a slight improvement in the accuracy. Finally, let's break out the servo to make some overvoltage events by regenerative braking. We'll make the servo move 2 revolutions, and when it breaks, we should see an overvoltage event. If you're new here, yes, the servo's pretty fast, and that was indeed 2 full revolutions, completed in under 300 milliseconds. That's a blink of an eye. Check out the previous video if you want to see slow motion footage of this same test. Zooming in on the oscilloscope, we've set the center line to 15 volts, and we are at 1 volt per division. So the overvoltage protection is kicking in pretty much at exactly 15 volts, which is great. The shunt switches off at 14 volts, so the 1 volt hysteresis we configured in hardware is also spot on. Repeating the test gets us the same result, so I'm pretty happy. Overall, this is a significant upgrade over the previous design, and I think we've satisfied all the design goals. This device will likely be in the background in my future projects, so keep an eye out for it. That's all I have for today. If you've enjoyed the video, please subscribe.